All righty, good morning. We're really excited to have Justin Chang here today. So Justin comes from Stanford, where he is wrapping up his PhD, co-advised by Yuri Leskovic and Michael Bernstein. Justin's a familiar face, having interned here, and also is the recipient of an MSR graduate fellowship. In addition to the MSR Fellowship, Justin has many other awards to his name. So he was a Facebook Fellowship awardee, although he declined it. He was a Stanford Graduate Fellow and earlier a Cornell Presidential Research Scholar. Also has a number of honorable mentions for papers, as well as a Best Paper Award at the recent CSCW conference. Justin's work lies at a very interesting intersection of sort of large-scale data analysis on the one hand, but also paired with HCI and experimentation on the other. And I think he applies those methods to very sort of intellectually rich and practically valuable topics, such as today's topic, which we're going to hear about, antisocial computing. So please welcome Justin to MSR.
All right. Thanks a lot for the introduction. I guess feel free to interrupt me at any point if any questions. Happy to take them. Oh, any end is fine too. So today I'm going to be talking about antisocial computing. So social media has brought us closer together, provides social support, helps us improve our mood, has been used for social good. You can think about things like the Arab Spring. But however, in recent years, what's becoming clear is that there is a dark side to social media and social computing. So trolling, online harassment, and misinformation are increasingly prevalent in many online platforms today. Even before the recent US presidential elections, maybe you're already thinking about what's going wrong with social media. Why are there so many trolls in online discussions? Why do I feel sometimes unsafe with posting things online? And why is there so much misinformation? And it isn't just a feeling. So antisocial behavior is commonplace. So a recent PewNet survey found that 4 out of 10 users online have been harassed, for example, being called offensive names or being sexually harassed. And other surveys as well give you like numbers that are even higher than this. And you know that it's a problem when many popular websites are so overrun with trolls that they've just decided to completely turn off the ability for anyone to comment. So is social media getting out of hand, and are online communities getting worse over time, and are we actually witnessing an epidemic of bad behavior? So ultimately, we want to build better, healthier online communities to combat antisocial behavior, and there are several ways to do this. So we can create better guidelines for online conduct, design better interventions, as well as develop better systems to combat such behavior. But to do this, first and foremost, we need to understand what's going on. So what do we already know about antisocial behavior? So prior work has largely characterized trolls as a vocal, small minority of people, and that antisocial behavior is due to the sociopaths. So in qualitative interviews, trolls largely come across as being very different from most of us. For example, taking immense pleasure in others' misfortune. Other work has also established trolls as having unique psychological traits, being more Machiavellian, being more sadistic. But rather than it being innate and the domain of sociopaths, my work shows that antisocial behavior or trolling can be situational and that ordinary people can be driven to troll. And so given this previous view on trolling, we might have concluded that simply removing the bad actors would make all our problems go away. But if trolling is situational, then we need a different perspective and need to ask a different set of questions to understand what's going on and what we can do about it. So here are three questions I'm going to answer in this talk. So first, we'll look at why trolling occurs or the causes of antisocial behavior or how anyone might become a troll. Next, we'll look at how such behavior might worsen over time and even spread from one person to another. And last, we'll take a bird's eye view of antisocial behavior and spreading behavior more generally and look at cascades and if they can be predicted. So how I do this is by complementing data mining and crowdsourcing. So I use data mining to find these generalizable insights and then combine this with crowdsourcing, which enables online experimentation, which can then enable established causal links. And so while this talk focuses on antisocial computing today, my work as a whole also involves other aspects of both data mining as well as crowdsourcing. So let's start with the causes of antisocial behavior and ask if anyone can become a troll. So again, before I continue, as a heads up, some of the examples in this talk may contain strong and offensive language. So in this work, we study antisocial behavior in the context of public commenting systems, such as CNN. So here's an article from CNN that from a few years back that shows talks about how women perceive themselves online. And here are some of the actual comments from this article. So here's one pretty insensitive comment. And here are the replies to that comment. So there's some name calling, some sarcasm, and it's mostly not very constructive. So understand these instances of antisocial behavior, like what I just showed you, in collaboration with Discuss. We analyzed a data set consisting of multiple large commenting communities. And so the data set we analyzed comprised about a terabyte of complete data over a year of activity from about 76 million users, a total of 470 million posts, and 831 million votes. But of course, before we can analyze trolling, we need a working definition of what it is. So here are four different definitions of what trolling is. So is it engaging in negatively marked online behavior? Is it not following the rules? Is it taking pleasure in upsetting others? Or is it disrupting a group while staying undercover? And a lot of these definitions make sense, right? Some of these are a bit broader. Some of them are more specific. Some encode intent. Some do not. And maybe your preconceptions of what a troll is or your experiences with these people may speak to even other definitions. But in this world, what we're interested in lies closer to bad behavior in general. So we take inspiration from some of these broader definitions and define trolling as behavior that occurs outside of community norms. So under this definition, regardless of intent, trolling happens as long as people are seen to behave as trolls. And why this is nice is that the community guidelines for many websites are very similar. There's no name calling, no personal attacks, no profanity, offensive material, and so on. And also by looking at how moderators moderate these communities using these guidelines, we can use these as signals to automatically identify who's trolling and who's not. But while trolls exist, again, we don't know very much about who's responsible for this bad behavior. And as prior work, as well as these headlines suggest, media portrays trolls as this group of misfits that are hopefully not any one of us in this room. But is this really the case? So what can looking at data tell us? So for instance, if trolling is innate, are trolls just trolling more often than not? So here's a plot showing the distribution of trolls who were banned from CNN, which you use as a proxy for trolls. And we might imagine that if trolls are inherently bad, then they have most, if not all, of their posts deleted by moderators. But while many of these supposed trolls do have most of their posts or all of their posts deleted, a sizable number also have a much smaller proportion of their posts deleted as well. So in other words, the distribution of trolls or people who are banned is bimodal. So could these two peaks correspond to two different types of antisocial behavior that goes on? So maybe the people who are writing bad content all the time are these lifelong regular trolls. Well, those only had a smaller fraction of their posts deleted. Maybe they were just having a bad day. And again, importantly, as a caveat, because we are looking at banned users, we are going to be underestimating the population of these situational trolls. And so overall, because of this observation, we started to reconsider our assumption that trolls are just a vocal minority. So rather than trolling being mostly innate, what if it was actually more situational? And of course, how would you even go about showing when any social behavior is situational? So we can make observations with data, but it's hard to demonstrate exactly what causes trolling. And if we did run an experiment, the issue might be that it won't generalize. So our solution was to combine both. So to conduct an online experiment simulating a discussion, as well as carry out an observational study of an actual discussion community. So the experiment helps us establish causality, and our data analysis lets us demonstrate replicability and generalizability. So now I'm going to claim that ordinary people can become trolls. And using evidence from experiments and data, I'm going to show you how it's possible to induce people to troll. And I'm going to do so first by drawing on two theories from social psychology, the first being the broken windows theory, which suggests that norms can strongly signal whether further bad behavior happens. For instance, that broken windows signal that crime was acceptable in the neighborhood. The second theory concerns how unpleasant stimuli, aversives, increase aggression. So one study showed how exposure to secondhand smoke increased a person's aggression towards other unrelated people. But still, much of this work was conducted several decades ago in the absence of online interactions and under different circumstances. So could this actually translate to trolling online? So to begin, we conducted an experiment on Mechanical Turk that simulated a discussion forum. So the general structure of the experiment was as follows. So we had participants take a quiz and then had them participate in an online discussion. And while varying the study conditions, we then ran many of these identical discussions in parallel to observe how participants' behavior changed. So in this experiment, we used a 2x2 between subjects pectorial design, where we modified the difficulty of the quiz, as well as the initial discussion context. So drawing on theories of aggression, we varied the difficulty of the quiz to influence participants' mood. And drawing on the broken windows theory, we varied whether the discussion context was good or bad. So what did this quiz look like? So the quiz that we asked participants to take looked like this, and it had about 15 questions. So the version in the positive mood condition was calibrated to be pretty easy, as above here, so that participants would get high scores and feel good about themselves. The other version of the quiz was a bit more difficult and designed so that most participants would score poorly. And in this version, we also told users that they did poorly on the test anyway, regardless of how they actually performed. And lastly, participants had 5 minutes to complete all 15 questions. So after completing the test, we then had participants take part in a discussion about the then upcoming US presidential elections. So for some context, this experiment was done during the 2016 Democratic primaries, where people were deciding whether to choose Hillary Clinton or Bernie Sanders for the Democratic Party's presidential candidate. So in the positive discussion context condition, we see the discussions with initially more neutral and more constructive comments, such as these. In the negative discussion context condition, these seed comments were more negative. Again, all of these are real comments, so I didn't need to come up with anything. So what happened? So first, as a manipulation check for mood, using a post-quiz validated mood questionnaire, we found that people were in a much worse mood after the difficult quiz than the easy quiz. So people also got worse scores on the hard quiz as well. Second, as a check for discussion context, we also found the initial seed post in the negative discussion context condition were perceived worse as well. And they were only 36% upvoted, compared to those in the positive context condition, which were 90% upvoted. So now on to our main result. So how much trolling was there in each condition? So here we had two expert raters label posts as trolling or not, blind to condition, and using standard community guidelines, such as from CNN.com. We then measured what proportion of posts made in each condition were troll posts. So if participants were in the positive mood and context condition, or that they saw the easy quiz and discussion without any initial trolling, the rate was lowest at 35%. So now this number might look high, but again, remember that participants were commenting on a relatively controversial topic at the time. If people got the difficult quiz or were shown troll posts previously, the rate of trolling increases in both cases by a similar amount. And if people got both the difficult quiz and were showed troll posts, this led to almost twice the incidence of trolling. So we tested the significance of these results using a mixed effects logistic regression model and found that both main effects are significant and that there are no significant interaction effects. Analyzing our data a different way, we can use Luke to measure the proportion of negative emotion words as a proxy for trolling behavior. And here we also find similar trends, so the proportion of negative emotion words almost tripling in the worst condition compared to the base positive condition. And to give you a sense of what participants actually wrote, so here are two examples. So here's one comment from the good condition. So when participants did the easy quiz and were shown neutral comments. So like this one, majority of them are pretty reasonable. But on the other hand, when people were in a bad mood, and or had seen prior troll posts, they wrote things like this. So in other words, bad mood and negative discussion context increase trolling. But now you might say that this is only a lab experiment, and so these results may not hold up in the real world. So what we did was also analyze an actual discussion community, CNN.com, to see if we could try to replicate our findings. So turning to data, here's what we found in relation to both mood and discussion context. So while we can't study mood directly from data, we can study its correlates. So for example, Prior measured how mood tends to swing with the time of day and day of week, and found remarkably stable patterns in how negative affect or the amount of negative words used on Twitter changes with time. So if we can observe similar trends with regards to indicators of trolling, that would be highly suggestive of mood influencing trolling as well. So here's a plot of the time of day on the x-axis and the proportion of flag posts on the y-axis. And what we find is that the post made in the morning is much less likely to be flagged for abuse than one made in the evening. And what's nice is that this matches Golder and Macy's findings about how negative affect changes with the time of day. Similarly, there are changes based on the work week as well. So post flagging and trolling is highest at the beginning of the work week and decreases as we near the weekend. And we didn't observe this just for the proportion of flagged posts. So across multiple indicators of trolling, trolling increases at the times of day and days of week where people are in worse moods. We also find that anger can lead to more anger. So just as we found that doing poorly on the quiz affected later commenting and discussion, negative mood spills over from prior discussions to subsequent unrelated ones. So to show this, we looked at a discussion with at least one flagged post and selected a user who was flagged and a user who wasn't at random. And so that we ensure that we aren't selecting people already trolls, we ensure that both users never had any of their posts flagged or deleted in the past. So now when each user goes on to post in a separate discussion, we then compare the likelihood of that future post being flagged as well. And what we find is that the user who was previously flagged was also more likely to be flagged in this later discussion. So in other words, if we compare users who trolled in previous discussions with those who did not, find that those who did were twice as likely to troll in this later unrelated discussions. So turning to discussion context, we can also directly replicate our experimental findings here and show that the initial post in the discussion can strongly affect the subsequent likelihood of trolling. So here we compare two top-level discussions of the same article, where one begins with a flag post and one does not. We find the discussion that begins with a flag post is more likely to have its subsequent post flagged as well. And here, the control for confounds, we excluded the OP, as well as users flagged or deleted in the past. So here, initial troll post increases the rate of trolling in subsequent posts by the users by about 63%. So that was context. So having established factors relating to trolling experiment and in data, as the next step, can we predict trolling before it happens? So here we examine the balanced data set of 120,000 posts so that random guessing results in about 50% accuracy. We then train a logistic regression classifier on the following sets of features: mood, context, and user features. So you can measure mood indirectly through flagging previous discussions along with diurnal changes. It can measure context just by looking at the prior posts in the same discussion. So the third is basically an indicator variable for every user. And these features let us test the relative importance of two hypotheses about whether trolling is situational or if it is innate. So here's what we found. So you just identify trolling behavior by finding these supposed trolls. We do kind of OK, getting about 0.66 AUC. But when looking at mood and context, we can do a little better. So mood alone does worse. But again, this is expected since we can't observe mood directly. But however, a discussion's context does outperform using these user-specific features, showing that extrinsic factors such as discussion's context is more important than these intrinsic user-specific features in predicting trolling. And of course, if we combine both types of features, we can do a little better at predicting if a subsequent post will be a troll post, even without looking at the content of the post. So to summarize, we might think about two factors that influence users to troll. So first, the mood sets a baseline for how susceptible they are to trolling. And when a user participates in a discussion, posts written by other users provide the spark or impetus to the user and directly results in them trolling or not. And so to end this section, because trolling is more situational than innate, ordinary people can become trolls under the right or wrong circumstances. So now you might be thinking, what could we do to mitigate bad behavior? So could voting be the answer? So voting is present in a lot of social media websites, with one popular example being Reddit. And so the concept behind voting is simple. So better content should get more upvotes, and worse content should get more downvotes. But does this actually work in practice? So here's another claim. So instead of voting helping to reduce bad behavior, we claim that it exacerbates the problem because downvoting can cause negative behavior to worsen. And so this is the next question that we're going to ask about how antisocial behavior might worsen over time. So in other words, could antisocial behavior spiral? Yeah.
So far, you haven't really distinguished different types of trolling behavior in the sense that it's like everybody's behaving in the same way.
Right.
But from your results and also some experiences, I think there are some kind of initiators of this kind of behavior and there are some followers. Mm-hmm. In the sense that just seeing other people doing this may become acceptable for others to do it, but if nobody had initiated this, people wouldn't be engaged in this kind of behavior. Do you think there are these inherent types of people and maybe still, you know, removing the initiators from this network may still be the solution for decreasing others as well?
Right, so I think that's a very good point about there being like initiators, right, versus people who are following. And definitely like community norms have something to do with the results that we're observing here, right? So that if some kind of like bad behavior is more acceptable, people are more likely to follow suit as well, right? And I guess post worse content of their own. So obviously one solution that many websites propose is that you might want to kind of like ban all of these like bad users from these communities. But I guess what my results here is showing is that you don't always want to do that because people can also randomly be bad at different points, right? If someone wakes up on the wrong side of the bed and they post like a troll comment, are you going to ban that user, right? Even though they're good 99% of the time. So what happens is that if you just remove these kind of like initiators, the fact that anyone can initiate these things as well means that maybe you should just ban everyone from the community, right? But obviously you can't do that. So I guess this kind of suggests that we need kind of like different sorts of interventions to kind of manage this kind of behavior. Definitely there are going to be people who are going to be trolling all the time and people who are also not going to be trolling any at all. But there are also a lot of people in the middle who kind of can be like induced to go one way or the other. So I guess thinking about like these different groups of people would be a good way to think about it. Yeah.
We have a question online.
Oh, okay.
Marco asks, was there a difference in discussion quantity between positive and negative content? Were there equal amounts of comments with each condition?
So here in the experiment, we required users to post at least one comment, and they could post more if they wanted to. So there were some differences here we observed, but they weren't very significant though. So again, like I'm going to preview results here, but generally like in negative conditions, you kind of tend to see a bit more commenting happening. But again, like in the experiment wasn't significant. I guess if we look at it at a larger scale, we might see differences, as I will show in a slightly different context in this next section.
Were posting their comments, were there names associated with the comments, or were they posting anonymously?
Right, so we assign like anonymous user IDs to each person. Yeah.
How might a real name policy have changed that?
I think definitely a real name policy is going to moderate the effects that we're observing. Again, like thinking about, I mean, literature, we know for a fact that kind of like anonymity kind of encourages like people to be kind of like disinhibited to some extent, right? But again, I guess thinking also about like anonymity is kind of necessary in some context, right? Especially with vulnerable populations. So I guess we can have real name policies and they can mediate trolling. On one hand, we can think about like these public discussions on Facebook and how those are not going very well either. On the other hand, we also need kind of these pseudonyms for cases where people want to protect their privacy. So definitely understanding the differences and the trade-offs that we have to make with kind of like having anonymous conversations versus pseudonymous conversations versus real name conversations versus real life conversations, and seeing like where we can kind of like bring things from one domain into another would be interesting to look at. Yeah.
So I know, you know, at the beginning you kind of laid out your personal definition of trolling that
mm-hmm.
you're using this experiment.
Mm-hmm.
But I think part of what AJ was getting at was that,
right.
you know, within non-normative behavior,
right.
there's a range. Like the example you showed of the person kind of being like, oh, Hillary Clinton's
right.
an idiot and
right.
I wouldn't vote for her. It's like kind of negative, but that's different than like, you're voting for Hillary Clinton and I'm gonna like look up your phone number and come to your house and
right.
like kill your family, which
right.
is the kind of thing people post, which is like more clearly trolling.
Right.
And I was wondering if in your experiment, the comments that you guys rated as the more negative comments, did you do any more kind of qualitative analysis within those to kind of break down like how many of those are on the like really bad, like threatening end of the scale versus
mm-hmm.
this more like a little bit negative end?
Right. So we didn't do this for the experiment, just because we're just looking at like, I guess, how this happens in general. But like personally, I've been also looking at, there was like some work I did where I was trying to categorize different types of trolling, kind of come up with like a coding scheme for different types of trolling that happens. So you could imagine that there's like, say, ad hominem attacks that could be doxing, like you mentioned, could be like people bring up hot button issues, people who make unsubstantiated claims, people just make really relevant comments, right? So there are many different types of trolling as well. And I think my future work here definitely should look into like how these different types of trolling happen. If you can predict like specific things that happen in some that are worse than others, as well as like which demographics engage in these different types of trolling as well.
One prediction that'd be kind of interesting is if it mirrors the sort of bimodal distribution you had, which is that there's this small set of people for whom all of their posts get banned, and then there's this other group that's kind of like the hair trigger group or whatever that can kind of be provoked, and maybe this is this sort of a similar thing where there's like this small amount of just like truly bad, and then there's this other stuff that's like offensive, but I don't know, slightly on the fence.
Because when it's like anyone can become a troll, I sort of wonder if that's what that actually is in practice. Anyone can become like a little bit mean and inappropriate, but in terms of like the people who are like, I'm gonna kill all the whoever's, or like
I don't think we're saying that people are going to kill or I guess threaten to kill other people, right, just by being exposed. But I mean, thinking about like even like just like seeing this level of negativity in comments, probably a bit more than would be acceptable, right? A lot of the deleted comments that moderators have on like these many websites also kind of speak like this is kind of the unacceptable behavior, and that I guess like if we think that is like okay, I mean, I guess that depends on the community as well, but also thinking about like how people might actually, do people actually want to participate in these kinds of communities, right? So we might be also excluding like groups of people who would have otherwise participated in a slightly more positive environment.
Was what, about 4% of posts get, is that what it was? It was about 4% get banned, right? I think that's what it was. You showed a graph that had the percent of posts that got banned. I think it was like 4% or something. You don't have to go back, that's fine. Anyway, just following up on the point, like 4% is kind of high. I assume it's not 4% of like, you know, I'm going to come after you
right.
type posts, right? Like probably some of those are a little more tame.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Well, can we let him continue on with the talk?
Are we ready?
No, it's a great discussion, but I want to make sure he also has time.
Since we seem to, I was just wanting to ask, between those two groups of trolls,
right.
do you see any, for example, linguistic characteristics that might distinguish them?
I think that's actually a really good idea, though, to kind of distinguish these two groups of users.
Yeah.
I mean, we kind of can kind of distinguish them. Some of the work that I was like looking at, trying to like say, oh, these are the people who kind of like only like were trolling like at the end of their life in the community, right? Just before they got banned, right? For that single infraction. All those people who are like trolling the entire time, throughout their life, and then they made like 100 posts before that were all deleted before they got banned. So I try to look at these different linguistic differences. Definitely would be interesting to do. Yeah. Thank you. Okay, so let's continue. So in this section, we're going to look at how voting has a role in how people get from bad to worse. So as votes are essentially a way for users to evaluate other users' content, and we subsequently describe them as evaluations. So here our goal is to see how people might react to not only negative but positive evaluations so that we can compare the differences. So what do we mean by a positive or negative evaluation? So here's an actual comment that got 5 upvotes and 4 downvotes. So together, these numbers can help us quantify how positive or negative an evaluation is. So in this work, we define a positively evaluated post as one where the proportion of upvotes is greater than some given amount, say the 75th percentile of posts in terms of the proportion of upvotes. So similarly, a negatively evaluated post is one where the proportion of upvotes is lower than some given threshold, say the 25th percentile. So given that a user received a positive or negative evaluation from the members of the community, how will that user's behavior change afterwards? So either could be possible, right? So operant conditioning says that feedback guides authors towards better behavior. So users would behave better after getting either a positive or negative evaluation. So an upvote means that you did well, and a downvote means that you didn't and should improve in the future. But on the other hand, bad is stronger than good. So bad impressions are quicker to form and more resistant to disconfirmation. And people have a much better memory for when bad things happen than when good things happen. So to answer which of this it was, we focused on 4 large commenting communities, and the results I'll show here apply to all of them. And you might recognize some of them from recent events as well. So say we have 2 users, one positively evaluated and one negatively evaluated. And if we look at these 2 users' posting histories, one important question we're going to ask is how either users' posts are evaluated before and after that middle positive or negative evaluation. So, but of course, simply comparing different users isn't going to work, because who's to say people who got downvoted are inherently worse commenters? So downvoted comment might also be inherently worse as well. So how might we solve this? So what we do here is conduct an observational study using propensity score matching. And the general idea here is you want to match pairs of users that have been up to a point of comparison as similar as possible, and then see what happens when they receive different treatments. So in our case, either positive or negative evaluation. So again, here are 2 users, one positively evaluated and one negatively evaluated. So of course, these 2 users are not going to be writing the same thing, but we want to ensure that they are. So what we do is first match pairs of users on text quality, which essentially turns text into a comparable number. But of course, what on earth is text quality? So here's how we compute it. So what we did is train here a machine learning model that only uses bigram text features of a post content to learn the proportion of upvotes, P, that it received. So we can then define the predicted proportion of upvotes as the text quality, Q, of the post, which we then can obtain just by looking at the text of that post. And we also might be concerned with bias in computing text quality, since the proportion of upvotes may be biased. But hopefully already doing reasonably well by only using text as our features. So as an additional check, you crowdsource labels of whether a post was good or bad, and using standard community guidelines as well, force up to the post where 10 crowd workers label each post. And from this, we can then obtain Q prime, or the true label of text quality. And so now to see how good Q is compared to P, we can correlate Q prime with P and Q. And here's what we found. So we find that text quality is far more correlated with the crowd's guess than the actual proportion of upvotes is. And what this is saying is that text quality is a reasonable but nonetheless noisy approximation of Q prime. And we can also observe that the error between Q and Q prime is distributed relatively randomly for different values of Q, so there's no systemic bias in using Q to estimate Q prime. So but back to the problem. So to match pairs of users, we first ensure that these 2 posts have a similar text quality. And we also control for the length of posts or number of words. So we further made sure that these users' complete posting histories are similar before this positive and negative evaluation. For example, ensuring that they had a similar number of posts and a similar number of upvotes on their posts. After controlling for these factors, we now have matched 2 users that are basically indistinguishable from each other on our match covariates, only that one user got a positive evaluation and the other got a negative evaluation. So here's how we actually do this. So we identify the covariates we want to control for, including text quality, which I showed you, as well as the number of prior posts. We then identify an outcome variable of interest. And then to control for these covariates, we estimate the propensity for which users likely to be assigned to each treatment condition, and then use these estimated scores to compute an optimal pair matching using the algorithm of choice. And for replicability, we also tried matching directly using coarse and exact matching with empirically similar results. So after controlling for our covariates, how should we measure how subsequent posts are evaluated? So other than text quality, which I mentioned earlier, how else might we measure changes in evaluation? So to answer this question, we also need to understand what an evaluation is made up of. So essentially, there are two components to an evaluation. So when we evaluate something that someone wrote, both the something, the content, and the someone, your preconceptions of that person, both affect these evaluations. So the first component are these textual effects, or text quality, right, or how well people write. So in other words, was a post downvoted because it was badly written? The second component relates to community effects, or how the...
When you say badly written, right, do you mean the... Like your example here suggests that you mean the inclusion of words from some taboo word list, which is different, perhaps, than content that doesn't contain bad words but is of low quality because it's not grammatical, or it's too long, or too short, or are you, what criteria are you using?
Right, so here we are using a model to kind of estimate like how likely a post is to receive an upvote. And so there we are kind of like using like these existing signals of like what was deleted, what was not, or what got upvoted, what got downvoted as a proxy for like what is good content and what is bad content.
So what do the features in that model end up being? Do they end up being mostly the presence or absence of particular taboo words, or is it other things like non-normal spelling or punctuation?
So it's going to be kind of a combination of this, since we kind of like use a bigram model here, so we're just going to be looking at all the words in the data set and trying to kind of estimate which things are going to be more likely to indicate bad behavior and which ones that are not going to be indicating bad behavior. So it's going to contain, I guess, examples such as this, such as swearing. It's going to contain like topics as well. It's going to contain like misspellings for sure, and I guess like all these features. But obviously like, these are not perfect. So we're not going to capture all the different types of trolling that goes on, right? Like it's going to be difficult, more difficult to detect like sarcasm. So yeah, this is like have the measure that we're using right now.
Are you training a classifier for each context independently, or this is like a general classifier for all five?
Oh, so we are training an independent classifier for each community that we looked at, just because that the type of content that gets upvoted and downvoted does differ depending on what community that we look at. And also like if you actually go try to like do train and test on different communities, those are actually going to do very badly. So, yeah.
But not for individual articles for the same.
No, not for individual, but so we treat that as a whole community though. Any more questions? Okay.
No, I have another question.
Yeah.
So I can imagine that the way the platform is using these signals affect how people are reacting to this bad versus uploading. For example, on CNN, as far as I know, you know, you just see all the comments in order. It's just you see this as a signal, but in some communities, your post may be shown higher or lower with respect to how people are voting you. Mm-hmm. Is this treatment of the platform in terms of, you know, these ups and downs, mm-hmm, is it homogeneous across the four societies you look at? And whether that would be an effect on, you know, people's behavior afterwards?
Yeah, so definitely. So we did look at the effect of like comment ranking I guess, whether things were upvoted or downvoted, how they were perceived. Again, like all these four communities use the same kind of commenting plugin, so the interface is the same. Users have the choice of picking like what order in which they want to see comments, right? Whether it's like earliest to latest, or like most upvoted to most downvoted, I guess. I guess we don't have a way of kind of understanding what these settings are, or how exactly these comments were displayed. I think it's going to have some sort of effect, which I am not entirely sure what that's going to do. But I imagine that these are going to be kind of like similar across these different communities as well.
Is there a default?
I think the default is kind of like earliest or newest to oldest. So yeah, I guess that could be another factor as well. But I imagine it's not going to affect our results very much, though. Yeah. So that was text quality, textual effects. And the second component relates to community effects, so how the community perceived that particular user. So does the user get downvoted regardless of what they post because the community simply dislikes them? So to start, let's look at the first component of an evaluation relating to the text of a post and ask if people write better or worse after a positive or negative evaluation, having controlled for a covariate such as text quality prior. So using a signed rank test, we find that post quality does drop significantly after a negative evaluation, but not after a positive evaluation, and that this is true in all the communities that we studied. And the change here only after a negative evaluation echoes findings in the positive-negative asymmetry effect from social psychology, and the intuition here is that you feel a lot worse after getting a negative evaluation, but not a lot better after a positive one. So people write worse after receiving a negative evaluation. So let's also look at how community perception changes after positive and negative evaluations as well. So for example, after receiving a negative evaluation, does the community... Yes.
The votings or evaluations as we're constantly...
Right.
So when someone... Are people even aware of how they've been evaluated? Like, does the system notify them? Because I can imagine... I never comment on it, so I have no idea.
Right.
I can imagine that I would leave a comment, and then I wouldn't check back and see later on how many upvotes and downvotes I got. Like, are they being notified, or do you have a way to know that they actually checked back and saw before they posted their next comment?
Yeah, so I think that's a very interesting point to make, because again, like, these websites don't tell you if you get upvoted or downvoted, right? So it's up to you to, like, go back to your comment to like see what happened, right? And I guess the interesting part is that we still can observe these effects even like with such difficulty in kind of like seeing what people have been doing to your comments as well, which kind of speaks to like the strength of these effects, right, on what's happening, right?
Well, or it could suggest that the effect isn't because they got downvoted and the negative feedback made them, you know, maybe it's some third thing. They wrote all those negative things because, like your earlier experiment said, they were in a bad mood for some other reason, right? That would also be...
Right, but I guess not everyone is in a bad mood at the same time, right? And so, like, we kind of, like, average this across, like, the, like, people in general, right? So we're looking, like, all people, and we're trying to match people that are similar as possible. Obviously, you're not going to be able to tell if, like, someone who made the same number of posts or like kind of wrote similar things up to this point are going to be, maybe one was suddenly in a bad mood and one was suddenly in a good mood. But I guess we are going to try to kind of like tease these factors apart as far as we can, though.
Certainly be neat to do something where like you made sure that people saw with the feedback. I think your hypothesis is that would be an even stronger
right.
effect, right? Because
right.
you're seeing the effect that you're seeing even without
right.
the explicit feedback, so it'd
right.
be neat to see that.
Right. Yeah.
So just to follow up on that, so you did this matched evaluation, right?
Right.
People who were very similar
right.
in the textual features beforehand.
Right.
Did you check to see that the textual features, I mean, I assume there was some weighting involved, right, of all of these things, that the mood-related words, for example, were included as strong features in the matching?
Mood-related words. So we didn't go to that extent of looking whether mood, I guess we didn't consider mood as a point of interest in this experiment as well, but definitely that would be interesting to kind of specifically control for, right? To kind of get more of this like thing. So we could weigh like mood words maybe higher if we want like control for kind of affect, right? Like I guess that we could then make an even stronger claim, right? If like two things would have similar affect, so to speak, as well. But in some ways we are trying to indirectly do that through the word matching as well. So yeah, but not we don't do that explicitly. Yeah. So, but of course, I haven't showed you how community bias is computed. So, for each post in our data set, so we have the number of upvotes, downvotes, as well as text quality, all scaled to be between 0 and 1. And comparing the actual evaluations with the predicted text quality, we can then see if the community is positively or negatively biased. So what do we find? So what we find here is kind of a halo effect. So posts made after a negative evaluation were perceived worse than we'd expect, but not after a positive evaluation. So in other words, the community is predisposed to downvote you if you've been downvoted in the past, regardless of what you write. So in CNN, your posts are on average being evaluated about 30 percentage points worse than would be predicted by text quality. So to visualize these findings so far, say we have two posts by two different users, one positively evaluated and one negatively evaluated, with the y-axis signifying how positive the post is. So first we control for text quality of these two posts, and then we also ensure that the users that wrote these two posts have similar posting histories. We then look at what happens to text quality after the positive or negative evaluation. We find that text quality drops after a negative evaluation, but not after a positive one. If we further compare the changes in community bias or others' perceptions of these posts, we find that perception worsens as well after a negative evaluation beyond what text quality indicates. So in summary, here's what happens to negatively evaluated users. So not only do they write worse posts after, but these posts are perceived worse by the community, and there's more bad news. So you'd hope that maybe negative feedback discourages people from posting, but people who are negatively evaluated are also more likely to post more frequently than those who are positively evaluated. And also, they are more likely to evaluate other users' posts more negatively as well, so they retaliate to being downvoted by downvoting others. So let's update our model of trolling. So mood as well as context through what other people write can cause people to troll. But beyond just writing, downvoting can also make things worse. So bad behavior can feed back into the system as people who get trolled or downvoted are more likely to troll and downvote others as well, resulting in a negative spiral. So what this really means is that a troll might have started out as an ordinary user, but then got downvoted, started to write worse and be perceived worse, and really never recovered after that. So given that antisocial behavior can spread from person to person, on a macro level, can we actually observe this downward spiral in communities? And so as some food for thought, here's a slide on how the proportion of upvotes given on CNN is changing over time. And so on the x-axis here is time from 2012 to 2013, and we note that it starts out higher than proportional upvotes, but it's gradually decreasing as well. So what happens is that if we leave negative behavior unchecked in a community, it can have far-reaching effects in the long term and cause the community to worsen over time. And more work needs to be done here. But overall, it's interesting to see how these microscopic interactions between individuals may translate to macroscopic observations. So at this point, I've talked about how antisocial behavior and how it might spread from person to person, but haven't talked about what's going on at a macro level. So how is bad behavior and bad information spreading on these networks? And yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we were talking about downvoting and upvoting, and then I think you made a conclusion about trolling.
Right.
And I just have a question about whether they really mean the same thing. For example, imagine a discussion platform, but highly liberal views are represented there, somebody may come in and just make a statement about, you know, promoting conservative values. And people may downvote that person because they don't agree with the view, but it's a valid view. Is it the same thing as trolling in that sense?
I think first we also have to ask, like, if what is a valid view and what is not, right? And so what we do is kind of like, I guess for each of these communities, just look at what the community as a whole thinks, right? And I'm not saying that this is the best approach that we can take here. Obviously, like in the liberal forum, what's going to be acceptable and unacceptable are going to be different from, like, say, a conservative forum as well. So which is why, like, we kind of did this analysis across these different platforms, right? So CNN, Breitbart, so on, right? Or even specific topics like gaming or like K-pop, right? So again, like understanding, like, downvoting has these effects, right? Regardless of what intent people have in downvoting things, we also did a study on, like, how things that get downvoted differ from things that are upvoted, and on average, these things are kind of like more unacceptable, right? Even though lots of people have different reasons for downvoting things, so it's again going to be kind of this, like, noisy indicator of, like, what's what's kind of better in relation to this community and what's worse. So this is the framework we're kind of working in as well, and I'm trying to define trolling in this kind of broader way. Obviously, there are many different views on what trolling exactly is, right? From the more specific definitions to the broader definitions as well. So, but happy to talk about these kinds of like differences afterwards too.
Just one clarification. Yeah. In the previous slide, you had the the proportion of upvotes going down.
Mm-hmm.
Does that, is that an like inverse correlation with the size of the community, or does nothing to do with the size itself?
So this is a proportion of upvotes. So I guess it's going to be kind of normalized by the total of votes, right? So the total of vote, total number of votes is going to go up. But again, the amount of downvotes happening is also proportionately increasing as well.
I think you're asking about, like, is the community just getting more diverse because it's getting bigger, and therefore you're just getting kind of, like, say, more healthy? So there's a positive interpretation of that, which is, like, healthy discussion is going on.
Right, like, if it's
like,
just me and Scott talking to each other at
right.
the beginning,
yeah.
you know, there's not much disagreement. But there's, like, 10 million people, then there's a wider range of views, and you'll see that going down.
Mm. Yeah, I guess also, which kind of, like, I'm going to talk about this a little afterwards as well, and like future work as well. So, because we haven't looked a lot at like how these things affect, like why this happens, right? Is it that there's more trolling? Maybe the diversity has a role to play in this, and I guess I'll talk about this afterwards. And happy to talk more about this on a one-on-one as well. Yeah.
Could you show this for the proportion of downvotes as well?
I guess the number of upvotes is just one minus the number of downvotes.
But you were actually. You had different thresholds for positive one and negative, right?
Right.
Like one was below 0.2 and one was higher than
right.
0.8.
Yes.
So that doesn't necessarily mean one minus.
Well, it was just to be considered bad or good.
Yeah.
An upvote is just a straight up
right.
vote. It's
right.
It's binary.
Right. So
I was wondering, like, when you look at the proportion of comments that get downvotes,
mm-hmm.
versus the total number of comments.
Can you say that again?
We can.
All right. Okay. So it's the spread of antisocial behavior predictable, right? So popping out one level in this section, we're going to turn to what happens when bad things cascade. So beyond bad behavior, something that's been also getting attention recently is bad content, right? Or more generally, rumors. So rumors don't only come in the form of fake news. So once in a while, you see these image memes make the rounds, and you might wonder why these things keep appearing. So while we're studying rumors, something we notice commonly is that the same rumor can have wildly differing levels of popularity. So here are two examples of people sharing the same rumor from before. So why did one get no reshares while the other got 416? And so what's worrying here is that the one on the right that was more popular, many of its comments also call it out as fake, but it still got reshared so much, right? So what is going on? So rather than focusing on the rumor itself, perhaps we can also learn something from understanding the underlying network in which rumors, misinformation, and fake news propagate. So if we analyze the cascade that makes up the spread of a rumor, we can now ask the broader question of whether these cascades are predictable and where our findings can then be applied to both rumor cascades as well as the spread of other information cascades. So for some background as to what a cascade is, so here's a friendship network with edges connecting friends. So suppose that I share a rumor, maybe two of my friends decide to share it as well, and two more people see this rumor shared by one of my friends and share it themselves, and as more and more people share this, a cascade is formed, here highlighted in gray. So although we want to predict how a cascade grows, there's evidence that these cascades may be inherently unpredictable. And there are several compelling reasons why this might be. So first is that large cascades are rare. Right? So shown here is the distribution of the size of reshare cascades on Facebook. And as you can see here, the number of cascades that get large is vanishingly small. So less than 10% of cascades reach 100 reshares. And because large cascades are so rare, it might be hard to predict when they occur. So past research has also provided more evidence. So in the famous Music Lab study, participants used a music ranking service to rate songs, and the goal was to see which songs would become most popular when the experiment was repeated many times. So what the study found was that it was hard to predict which songs would get popular in each instance of the experiment so that increasing the strength of social influence increased inequality and unpredictability of success. So this suggests that it may be difficult, if not hopeless, to predict whether something will become popular or if a cascade will grow large. So another thing that makes cascades unpredictable is that they can die down and then resurface or recur after a long period of time. So in contrast to prior work and perhaps our intuitions, what I want to show here is that cascades are actually predictable. So not only can we predict a cascade's future size, we can predict how its structure will change and how identical pieces of content can be differentiated. And we can also predict if they will come back from the dead. So let's begin with the task of formulating the prediction problem of predicting the growth of a cascade. So given that we have seen some number of reshares, how should we predict its future growth? So there are several possibilities here. So maybe you could ask if a cascade will get a large number of reshares. You could try to use regression to predict how large a small cascade will get. And perhaps you can also look at only the largest cascades and compare them to random cascades. But each of these have different problems. There are issues in terms of the size of each class, the distribution of data, and how data was selected in the first place. So how might we formulate a prediction task that doesn't suffer from these issues? So what if we instead ask if a cascade will reach the median? So by definition, the median splits the data set 50-50, so you have a balanced classification task. So now you might ask, what is the median f of k? And perhaps more intuitively, the question of whether a cascade will reach the median size is equivalently a question of whether it will double. And this follows because the size of a cascade tends to follow a power law distribution with exponent 2. So to formally define the cascade growth prediction problem, we ask, given that a cascade has obtained k reshares, will it double in size? And what's good about this approach is that it results in a balanced prediction task and allows us to track the growth of a cascade over time by varying k. So over 28 days, we sampled 70 million public photos uploaded to Facebook, which resulted in 5 billion reshares, and tracked these reshares of these photos following their initial uploads. Yes?
Any photo, or is this like in your original example, they were photos that were like screenshots of textual
Any public photo.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So we looked at four different sets of features. Content features, whether it had overlaid text or not. So we can try to kind of differentiate like the types of photos to get uploaded, whether they are images of nature, if they look more like memes and have text in them. We also looked at user features, friend count, gender, structural features, because cascades are basically directed acyclic graphs, so we can start to understand them that way as well, and temporal features, right? So how fast are these things spreading? Yes?
When you say the content features has overlay text, are you talking about specifically analysis of the image itself, like whether there's text in the image, like a meme kind of caption? Or are you talking about, like in your earlier screenshots, you know, people, when they share the photo, they might add their own comment in the comment field on Facebook, which may or may not be
right,
better.
No, we're looking at the image itself.
So you don't look at all at what people say in their Facebook post when they repost the image?
No, we don't look at that part of it. No. But we did do some separate analysis looking at that, but I guess that turned out to be not as predictive. So, yeah. And so if we look at predictability, what we can find is that we can predict cascade growth reasonably well. So again, using a logistic regression classifier to predict if a cascade that reached 5 reshares will double in size, we find that performance is robust independent of feature sets. So even without temporal features, we don't lose too much in accuracy. So cascade growth is predictable at least for 5 reshares. But what if the number of reshares observed increases? So what happens to predictability as we observe more of a cascade? So is it easier or more difficult to predict if a cascade with 5 reshares will grow to 10 reshares, or if a cascade with 10 reshares will grow beyond 20 reshares? So on one hand, maybe because you have more data in the second task, then the second task is easier. On the other hand, the second one is a harder, more complex question, and you might have to also predict further into the future. So which is it? So what we find is that as a cascade grows larger, it becomes easier to predict if it will double, and the results here demonstrate that observing more of a cascade while predicting further into the future is easier than observing a cascade early in its life and predicting what it will do next. So again, what's nice about this approach is that it lets us continue to ask, as a cascade grows from small to large, whether it's going to continue doubling in size.
Quick question.
Yeah.
In doubling, excuse me, doubling is still the median?
Yes,
doubling. Even when it's very large?
Right, so again, like because you kind of constrain on like, so we know that we're looking at all cascades that have reached like 50 reshares, right? So the median of all cascades that have reached 50 reshares is 100 reshares. Right.
So it's still balanced.
Yes.
Yeah.
I missed it. Was one of the features that you are looking at temporality? Like, does it matter how quickly the reshares happen within each other for predicting?
Yes.
So that's one of the, okay.
Yeah. So, but not only is cascade growth predictable, so for instance, we can predict if a cascade will be structurally more or less viral, and if a cascade will recur or come back. So if this was the individual view of antisocial behavior from before, so this might be how the network view looks like, where posts, comments, votes, and rumors may be transmitted from person to person, but also result in long-range, far-reaching cascades in the network. So to conclude, so here's an overall summary of what we found. So we found that trolling is situational, and that a person's mood or context of a discussion can influence them to troll, meaning that ordinary people can end up trolling under the right or wrong circumstances. So further, we also found that trolling behavior can spread, so not only through these effects, but through negative evaluations or downvoting as well. And so finally, looking more globally and studying cascades of bad behavior and misinformation, we looked at the spread of rumors and of cascades more generally, and find that contrary to a prior belief that they are fundamentally unpredictable, that their spread or growth can be predicted. So as I mentioned previously, and I guess this was pointed out earlier, that this plot on how the proportion of upvotes is decreasing over time is very interesting, and one where more research is needed. Right? So are these observations due to cascades and due to things becoming worse, or is it also due to changing populations? Right? So how can we try to predict the trajectory of a community moving forward? And will a community eventually decline, and how long will that take? But overall, given these results that I presented about antisocial behavior and the talk about studying the demise of communities, it might be easy to feel cynicism and despair about the state of social media or social computing. But also, not knowing the mechanism for antisocial behavior, something I want to focus on is also on building better systems that deal with such behavior instead and encourage more pro-social ones. So, for example, here's how a context-aware discussion platform might use machine learning and interventions to encourage pro-social discourse. And depending on when a user might be likely to troll, different interventions may also be useful. So, for example, if you think that a user may be angry in the heat of the moment, we could delay posts for some time. So what I covered today is a small slice of work I've done in data mining and crowdsourcing, which has included large-scale analyses, experimentation, as well as system building. If you're interested in any of these topics, I'm happy to talk about them afterwards, too. So thinking more broadly, what I hope to accomplish through my research is to develop holistic end-to-end approaches to better understanding social systems. So combining large-scale analysis with experimentation, I hope to make generalizable observations that are backed by experiments that can establish causality and enable prediction. So for example, in my work in identifying the causes of trolling. I also hope to look at both the big picture interactions in networks and relate them to those between individuals. For example, in relating network theoretic properties of cascades to the mechanisms through which they propagate. And importantly, my research also seeks to leverage findings to develop new systems that better support our online interactions, for example, to build pro-social discussion platforms. So as a whole, my research shows how multi-methods analyses can allow us to identify patterns in data, verify hypotheses, make predictions, and develop social systems. So using such an approach, my work has contributed to an understanding of antisocial behavior and cascading behavior. In the future, I hope to continue creating new methods, tools, and platforms that further improve how we use technology to interact with one another. I'd like to acknowledge my advisors and mentors who helped me on my journey towards a PhD, as well as my collaborators, colleagues, and the institutions, including MSR, that have supported and continue to support me and my research. Thank you for listening, and I'll take more questions now.
Question. So I guess one of the things that came up when we were talking about trolling and how there's wide range of trolling, I think one of the most commonly accepted ways of thinking about trolling, which I'm curious if you looked at that in your research, is that really good trolling, it's not just about posting a comment and getting downvoted, because that's kind of an easy thing. Really good trolling is trolling a comment that leads to a lot of discussion and anger from other people, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so you looked at upvotes and downvotes, but I was wondering, like, to what extent the number of comments and the type of comments that are replies to that initial thing that you call trolling
mm-hmm.
comment plays a role in, you know, the spread of trolling or
right.
the, you know, the different metrics that you looked at.
Right. Right. So actually, let me see if I have a slide for this somewhere. So yeah, if we kind of like compare like how trolls and non-trolls differ, right? And so I guess I didn't talk about this afterwards. Obviously, you have more swearing and more profanity. And also, what you also find is that like these trolls also kind of like behave like less similarly to previous users, right? So they're going to be writing something that's a bit more different from whatever else that's been written in the thread so far. And I guess to speak to your point, you can measure them like in terms of like metrics, like how many replies they get, and they actually do get more replies, right? If we compare like people are trolling and people are not. Obviously here our definitions are different from like just like how do you maximize like the amount of anger or amount of trolling, right? Given that we only are kind of like identifying like kind of the worst instances, right? Other instances where moderators stepped in to ban people, right? I guess this is also, I guess, suggestive of those kind of metrics also having a role to play.
I guess connected to that, there is another aspect of effective trolling, which is the history of activity or the reputation of that user.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the most effective trolls tend to be people who have gained a certain amount of reputation among
mm-hmm.
Community. And the reason why they're harder to deal with is because you can easily kick out somebody who just posted once
mm-hmm.
and posted some short comment that is horrible, but it's just
right.
like a simple one.
Mm-hmm.
The harder part is often when you have people who have built a lot of following and respect in a community or among some people in the community, and they always engage in this type of thing. So, like, to what extent do you look at the history and reputation that people have gained throughout their participation in some of these communities?
So that's a good question as well. I think a lot of these like trolls that we looked at kind of like live for shorter periods of time than you might be imagining, right? But I guess again, like a lot of them kind of like tend to be around for a long time before they get banned. So we didn't really look as much into like, I guess, reputation as well, because these systems don't give you an easy way of like exposing like what is your history in this community, right? Without like going deep into like finding your discourse profile, right? By manually like looking up this user, right, on a separate website. So I think imagining that's going to be interesting to study, especially on like Reddit with the karma system there, and try to find out like what's going on, that kind of thing. And I guess also like speaking to like how could we even like deal with people who like kind of have established following in the community, and that I guess most of the time they are like good people and they have good things to say, but maybe they don't say them in the right way. I guess thinking about like how we might kind of ask people to reflect on like what this person is actually saying, right? Or like what they're intending to say, right? And I guess maybe education has a part to play as well. Like teaching people like here's the way to say the things that you wanted to say, right? In a way that kind of maybe resonates more with other people and doesn't cause as much controversy just for the sake of doing so. Yeah.
Just really quick follow up. So it strikes me that the two questions Andres asked uses the modifier really good trolling and effective trolling.
Mm-hmm.
I think both of those imply that trolling, like I think the normative definition of trolling does imply an intent. I think the way the media culture think of trolls is they're there specifically to disrupt the community.
Mm-hmm.
But your definition of trolling doesn't really take intent
right,
into
right.
account.
Yeah.
So can you just comment on the motivation? Is it just that it's like looking at non-normative behavior or bad behavior online,
right?
Is it just easier to study when you don't take intent into account, or?
I think like so definitely like intent is very hard to get at in data, right? Or even in experiments without like explicitly asking someone like what was your intent in posting this, right? So I think here like seeing like I guess interviews and qualitative approaches here are going to be better at kind of elucidating like what is the intent of people. Posting here, right? So we tried to like take a definition that's kind of like get that sets this aside for now, at least, to understand like good behavior and bad behavior, right? And so I guess like in a way, like I mean, like these different definitions of trolling do speak to like the whole bunch of work that we haven't done in this space, right? And then other people also excited about here. So I think, I guess that's the way, that's where we're coming from. It's going to be very, I imagine that maybe we might be able to kind of get at this a little bit with like NLP advances as well. I'm not as certain like how well we might be able to do with these kind of new like machine learning approaches, but maybe we may be able to get a bit of this, and also by looking at like different types of trolling that happen. So maybe swearing is like less, maybe more or less intent, right? And like these different like categories of trolling, like, or like doxing is obviously there's some like I guess hurtful intent there, more so than just like saying something that maybe just like a disagreeing view or something like that. So I mean, you may be able to identify intent like in those ways, or by asking people, or with I guess better predictions. I guess I see this as kind of like interesting future directions to move in. And you had a question too.
Yeah, so I mean, I guess sort of relating to, you know, what's the right definition of trolling, or to the question of, you know, what's the right set of interventions to put in a system.
Right.
I imagine the answer is very different depending on who your target user group is. And I was wondering if you had identified that or talked to people from different target user groups to understand the values better. Like, for example, let's say we're talking about news websites like CNN, because mm-hmm. you use that a lot with your commenting. Mm-hmm. It seems like the target user could be, you know, the CNN company itself more broadly. Mm-hmm. The target user could be the author of the individual article or the subjects of the article. The individual user could be an average reader of the article and comment section who is not themselves going to comment. The average user could be people who are participating in the commenting community on articles. And I imagine each of these, like maybe CNN itself thinks it's great if there are comments along certain parts of the trolling scheme. Like probably CNN itself doesn't want like actual harassment and threats because maybe there's legal liability, but maybe CNN loves the like Hillary Clinton's a bitch comment because it creates more controversy and engagement among their readers, but maybe the subject of the article doesn't like the Hillary Clinton's a bitch comment because it makes them feel bad about themselves. And so whose opinion matters in terms of choosing which interventions to deploy? Do you have any thoughts on that? Or
right. So I guess for me, like I've not thought as deeply on these things. I've mostly been focused on the data and the experiments. I guess looking forward, though, definitely, I think there's kind of an interplay between these different things, right? Between these different stakeholders. I think, like in general, like speaking to the small number of news organizations that I've spoken to, that I think they all see like good comments as actually being like helpful in like kind of increasing the sense of like this is a place like where public discourse happens. I think one good example is the New York Times, where they kind of feature good comments. I guess a lot of people also like have this sense of, oh, the comment section in New York Times is actually valuable to read, and that it gives me a different perspective of what's going on in an article. So in that sense, I feel like in many cases we have like an alignment of like here are these things that we kind of want to do, and here are these common things that are kind of good to have, right? Regardless of who you are, whether you are the owner of the website or you're a participant, right? I think for me personally, I think what is important is I think trying to encourage more people to comment, right? Because I think like here, like studying these commenters, we kind of have this like kind of unknown like subset of the entire population who does comment, right? And there are a lot of people who do not comment because these comments are kind of terrible, right? So, I mean, even just like setting aside like the types of trolling that you might think about, like the doxing, right? Which actually like happens like very rarely on these commenting sites, but then just the harassment, right? And like the swearing and the profanity. These kinds of things are still like very common. And like just looking at the data, there's a lot of this that just happening that is not like flagged or not banned, right? Or not downvoted, right? And so I guess that even just like kind of cleaning up like what's happening, right, as a first step, right, to kind of like remove to fix all of the broken windows in these communities can create this like more better environment where I guess we can have disagreement that still happens, but that is not to the extent that kind of you troll someone. But I think we can try to start to I guess, look in that direction more broadly. So, yeah.
Is there a possibility to look at sort of the effectiveness of trolling, I guess is kind of what you're talking about, by looking at the, I guess, you know, do trolls cause more cascades? Or are cascades more predictable if it comes from a troll or something like that? Or are certain trolls, or maybe there are certain people who do kick off cascades, and then, you know, working backwards, what are their properties? And maybe that gets it, maybe that would be a way to get it intent.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, like, I guess from the cascades point of view, like, what happens is that a lot of these cascades are started by these people with, like, large followings, right? But I guess, like, not, again, like, not from the standpoint of, like, knowing, like, what are the particular, like, personality characteristics. I think that would be an interesting angle to get at there. I guess, like, here we kind of show, like, the one step, like, here's one person's comment and how that makes some other person's comment worse. Is looking at that multi-step process as well would be interesting too. Yeah.
Coming back to Justin's and Andreas's question about, like, intent. One group of trolling where you can see the intent is this organized trolling,
mm-hmm.
that happens through
mm-hmm.
external communities and then pushing it to some other communities.
Mm-hmm.
Have you thought about, like, what kind of behaviors happen when people are coordinating their trolling outside?
Mm-hmm. Right. So I think one challenge with this is that, so I actually have tried to, like, look at these communities, but they're also kind of relatively opaque to outsiders. I spoke with a CNN moderator one time, and then he was, like, pointing me to, like, this, like, Tumblr page where there were, like, a small group of trolls, like, organizing. So which page on CNN are we going to attack next, right? So, like, do, like, maybe, like, one page a day or one page a week or something like that. But there was kind of, like, a lot of, like, weird terminology that was being used. And I guess a lot of the times, like, these websites are kind of, like, on, like, the invisible part of the web, right? Where you can't, like, easily get a large amount of data about how this kind of organized trolling is, right? Or how pervasive it is. So what we instead did was there's some upcoming work where we try to look at people who control multiple accounts, right? To understand how those might kind of affect discussions, right? So as a quick, like, a summary of what we found is that that's going to be, like, a very small proportion of users on the order of, like, a couple of thousand versus, like, the hundreds of thousands or, I guess, millions of users that we get in these websites. But that these users kind of, like, there are, like, two groups of them. The first group is the type that you might imagine where they all participate in the same discussion to try to kind of, like, create the sense that of support for a particular opinion. But then a lot of these sock puppets, people who control these multiple accounts, are also just wanting to have different personas for different topics. So you might have one persona for talking about politics, one for talking about science and technology, and one for talking about, say, like, sports. So I think here we also kind of, like, graze the surface of, like, what's happening, right, with the organized trolling, with multiple people controlling, or multiple accounts controlled by the same people. I think these are definitely interesting directions to push in. And I mean, like, also, like, here, I guess the issue is data. I know there's, if you're interested in this kind of work, there's some stuff out of, like, Harvard where, like, some people released, like, a data set of I guess, a list of organized trolls accidentally leaked, right? And then you could actually understand, like, oh, these are the actual people who we know are these organized trolls, then we can study them from that way. I'm also curious, like, you have any thoughts as well about, like, how am I even identify who is organized and who is not? So, yeah.
Cool. Good. All right. One more time. Great job. Thank you, Justin.
Thank you.